Great night. I love to be able to say how wonderful it is to see you all, but unfortunately I cannot, because the Canadian Revenue Agency says I am now legally blind. I have macular degeneration, so I have no central vision. So if I walk by you, please, I'm not being impolite, say hello, tell me who you are. Right? On to the business at hand. Thank God I come to praise Dead Fellows, not to bury him. Ted has made many significant contributions to the cultural life of this country. Among them, his son Lawrence, his daughter Samantha, Edwina, and Megan.
Yeah.
Of course, he must hear the credit to those wonderful people with their mother, yes, the beautiful and talented actress Dawn Greenwald. Now, occasionally something good comes out of Ottawa. Ted Fellows is one of those good things. As an Air Force brat, he followed his father around to all these postings around Ontario and out west, including places like Calgary and fortunately Winnipeg. And it was in Winnipeg that the young Ted Fellows, working with the community theater there, played the lead role in the Scottish play. His Banquo was another young actor named Douglas Rain. Yes. And then Ted appeared in a one-act drama festival for which he won a scholarship to the Banff School of Fine Arts. So Ted went off there, and that prepared him for his first professional job. And that was with Sidney Risk's Everyman Theatre, which I believe was the first professional theatre in British Columbia. It could be wrong, but I think I'm right. And there, he had his first professional gig for the astounding amount of $10 a week, plus bed and board. And he got to work with such future notables as Arthur Hill, Murray Westgate, Drew Thompson, as they set off on an 80 performance gig from BC to Winnipeg and back, with three plays, one of which was an original Canadian play called The Last Caveman, about the discovery of oil in Alberta. I think it's time to bring that one back. But Ted ended up actually doing 2 years of an honors history study at the University of Winnipeg. But when he ended up in Toronto, the University of Toronto wouldn't accept his credits. But he conned them into letting him do an honors program in psychology. And he did graduate. And has never used it. But his time in the University of Toronto really was the time spent at Hart House with the legendary Bob Gill. There he worked with some wonderful people and met wonderful people like Arby Lockhart, Charming King, Bill Hunt, Eric House, David Gardner, and my future mentor, Alvin Shaw, and the Davis brothers, and their sister, Barbara Chilcott. And after that, off they went to the Straw Hat Players. Then it was the Canadian Repertory Theatre with Amelia Hall. Then, of course, he took a vacation to the UK and had, I think, at least 3 years working with various reputable UK repertory companies. He came back to Canada, did 4 seasons at Stratford, and more importantly, did 5 seasons crisscrossing this country and parts of the United States with the Canadian Players under Douglas Campbell. So, eventually, once again, he became a founding member of a company, and that was Neptune Theatre in 1963, under the direction of Leon Major, who had this incredible idea of signing actors to a 12-month contract with 2 months paid vacation. Oh. All for $150 a week. Ted, of course, you can Google it. He's done a lot of film and television, most notably for me, co-starring with John Vernon in Wojak, and then doing the title role in The Queen. I gotta tell this Ted story. It's the only one I'll tell. When Ted first came to work for me in Fredericton, we used to go out after the show to a place called the Club Cosmopolitan. Dancing all night, Richard Hatfield, our premier, would be there, he was there. And I had this wonderful 19-year-old PR girl who danced with Ted Falls. While dancing with her, Ted said, "So, what's it like dancing with McQueen?" She didn't know what to say. She came to me later and she said, "Walter, I thought Mr. Follows was straight." he asked me, "How's it feel dancing with the Queen?" When I went to the Playhouse at Fredericton in 1968 and was getting ready for my summer season of four plays, my mentor from my days at the University of New Brunswick, Calvin Shaw, said, "Contact my old friend Ted Follis. He knows everybody." So I contacted Follis, all of him, directing and acting, but he couldn't because he was making money doing The Queen. But eventually he did come to TNB and did a production of How the Other Half Loves, which sold out around the province. And that began our working association that went on for years. He's followed me everywhere. I had to direct him, and he's directed me. I mean, he did a production of Othello in which he cast me as the Duke of Venice. It was a peasant role for me. And this very thin young actor named Greg Wanless. What can I say? But Ted went on to do many shows for me. I directed him, he directed me. He also did two world premieres of Nolan and Learning Plays. He did The Incredible Murder of Cardinal Tosca for TNB, starring as Dr. Watson himself, and did it again at the St. Lawrence Center. And when I moved to Vancouver, the very first play I did was The Black Bondspieler of William McCrimm. Ted played the devil, our poor Brit. And did the world premiere of the Nolan and Learning The Gift to Last. I don't know why I never hired him when I was running the Charlottetown Festival. And I mentioned that to somebody, and they said, "You must have heard him sing." When I went back to TNB in the 90s, late 90s, Ted came back into my professional life in a production of Lend Me a Tenor, in which he played Saunders. And he astounded myself and the other cast members when, from a standing position, he leapt, flew through the air, and landed on Brian Mackay, who was lying in bed as Tito. Well, I gotta tell you, it almost gave me a heart attack. Well, in fact, it did give me a heart attack. Because when we were touring in Sussex, New Brunswick, with that show, I had a heart attack. And thank God, David Nairn, who's here tonight, was there to walk me around the snow-covered outside of the Amsterdam Inn. Well, Ted, of course, wasn't there to assist me. He was out checking out the nightlife in Sussex with his daughter, Megan. But speaking of heart, last March, Ted had open-heart surgery. And then, amazingly, this fall, he did the lead role in a staged version of King Lear. And then went on to do a Christmas show. Charles Dickens writes A Christmas Carol. Now, I credit his recovery with the care and concern of his beautiful and talented musician wife, Susan. Anyway, it has been a joy to know, work with, and love Ted. And it is a great honor to be here tonight to present him with this Life Award. Ted.
in the water. Just the wee dog on the top of the hatch. You're supposed to be funny. Or sing. And you heard about that. Well, I guess I can throw out the one I made. I made it in 77. I thought I was old then. I have to tell you this. Two things. I'll tell you more if you're not bored to death. Two things. One, every man should have a Newfoundlander in his life. Just one. Two, and you're in serious trouble. One will teach you how painted you can do a house. The colors, the scenery, they are special people, and my friend over here is a prime example of what it is to be a Newfoundlander. Secondly, my friend over here that I managed to direct a couple of times, and I thought he would at least have the nerve to say tonight, is that there was a book a few years ago written about sayings of Canadian actors and all that, and there's a statement by Dan McDonald in it. Do you remember?
Yes.
Do you remember what you said?
Well, no.
No.
You can't remember what he said tonight?
Well, he did stumble a bit, because he had a script. What he said in this book many years ago was that he had been working with Ted Follows, who was the best actor-director he had ever worked with. Shortly after that, he left Equity and joined ACTRA. What I wanted to say, because Walter has done my whole life story.
Not yet.
Oh, by the way, my Equity number is 151. Is there anybody under that number?
736, sorry, Ken.
Yeah. Oh.
1036. My actor number is 1101. I mean, 151. All the others? Here's your paw. What I wanted to say earlier was said much better by Mr. Beatty, whom I have also had the pleasure of working with, because he was talking about Greg, whom, as Wallace said, we gave a job when he was starving. And when he started his company, he never reciprocated. But you all, as performers, know that feeling of helping and being. But what I wanted to say was that Greg was saying about these guys who really do the work. It's wonderful to be an actor like myself and be a member of three or four theatrical companies and come and join and make $150 a week. I wouldn't have money. Except the one thing I never forgave Leon for was that Miss Greenhouse, to whom I was married at the time, was paid $135 a week. And, just for your information if you don't know, the two opening shows of the Neptune Theater were Major Barbara and Mary Mary. And guess who played Barbara and Mary Mary?
Don Green.
And not only that, she had had our second child 2 months before that. But Walt is right, Leon gave us that first contract. We went to New York for 2 weeks, saw Laurence Olivier playing the entertainer, and then went back. I loved living in Halifax. We almost stayed there. David Brenton stayed there. Great, great place. So, that was what Dougie Campbell with the Canadian Players. Walter mentioned, some of us said, we played every state in continental USA over 5 years, not 4. 5 that I was with them. If you want a fast story, I'll tell you, the 6th year they were doing an Eskimo King Lear and Ladies Not for Burning, and Bill Huck was going to play King Lear. I had just finished doing 2 years of A Man and Superman with a Shakespearean movie, As You Like It, but I was Man and Superman. I played Striker, they called me Shelfa, the 1st year, and the next year Dougie left, and I played Jack Tanner, who played Toronto, and I love this story, Tony. Nathan Cohen, in his radio review of the show, said, Ted Collins and the Canadian Players were at the Royal Alex last night, and I saw, and I must say that Mr. Follows is the biggest hand to play the Royal Alex since Donald Wolfett's last visit. I thought that's pretty good. So, anyway, that was that. Another story and another artistic director who came tonight. After years with the, what we call the Straw Hat Players back in the 40s, that went on to many, along came Michael Ayew, who in 1986 came up with this idea of asking Ted Follows, Aaron E. Lockhart, and Eric House to come up at the beginning of the season of the Muskoka Festival, just because we were old timers and could maybe draw in a few more people. I think that's what he thought.
No, we wanted to recreate what you did with the Straw Hat Players.
Ah, there you are. So we came up, and I spent the next 5 summers, again, working with Michael, acting, directing, sometimes doing both, because he wouldn't pay me anymore. But people like Michael, Dougie, Leon Major, who did, and then started the Samoan Center, those guys, him, and my friend, I met in 86 working with Michael, a young man named David Nearman. A very self-assured actor. I think that's the nicest way. Anyway, we were doing an early Norm Foster play, and we have been friends from that day to this. Along the way, he met a young lady called Lisa Way, and suddenly, this artistic director emerge from this gallivanting and he has been so successful at Theater Orangeville that it's terrific. Those guys, Michael, David, Walter, Dougie Campbell, Leon Major that I knew, others that you know, Greg, they do the work. We come along and if we're lucky, and in my day, we get to participate. I've worked at the CRT in Ottawa. I did 32 plays in 34 weeks. That's how I learned about weekly record. We opened with Shakespeare because we had a whole week. Nothing to do at night. Then we did a play called Here Comes Mr. Jordan, which they made in the movies about the saxophone player. And I played that, so that was the lead. That was second. Third show was called The Butter and Egg Man. It was a Broadway hit. I couldn't learn a line. Not a line. I had lines.
Still.
No, now I just stumble up and look serious. Or if it's a joke, say it louder. And here's another fast story for you. They mentioned Vern Chapman. Have you, any of you read Who's in the Goose Tonight?
Yeah.
I'm so glad to hear that because it's a fabulous book and the story is about me. Because I felt outraged with Dora Mabel Moore and I retaliated and Vern put me on the cover of the book because I snuck back into the theater one night when I had been replaced. Do you want the whole story?
No. No.
I was working in Spring Thaw. And I was playing the goose in Mother Goose. And I did a dance at the end, and the last one. And at the same time, I was rehearsing a show for the Dominion Drama Festival with the University Women's Alumni Society. We were doing a Shaven play directed by Herbie Whitaker called In Good King Charles's Bloody Golden Days. In this play was John Colicoff, Ron Hartman, me. I played Isaac Newton. How do you know it? Isaac and Bill Needles. Vaughn. We won, of course. We won and we were invited then to the finals. So I went to Dora Mabel Moore. I was making $40 a week. That was all the money I had. It was wonderful. Went to her and said, Dora, I need a night off because I'm doing this. And I got a long lecture about how I had to decide whether or not I was going to be a professional or I was going to be an amateur. I gave my notice. A book was written later by George Bertakis' sister, who said that the reason I did it was because I was being paid by them. I wasn't. That was all right. I gave my notice, left, I was replaced. Then I found out that Dora Mabel Moore, Dora's son, was in the Spring Hall. He had to leave. Dora went to Bill Needles and said, Bill, Mabel's leaving, we'd like you to replace him. And Bill said, fine. Love you, but Bill said, I have to have a night off because I'm in this Dominion final show. And Dora said, oh, that's fine. Don't worry about it. We'll just get Mabel to come back. I thought, that's not right. So I And the goose scene was the last scene of Act One, so I thought it was Jack Marigold. Wonderful guy. Why he let me do it, I'll never know. But I talked him into my going in to the goose that night. And Jack Richardson, the stage manager, said, Dora always goes out and watches the end of Act One, so I'll go out and just crack it. I said, fine. Did it, went on stage, Pete Muse was playing Mother Goose, and I came on stage and Peter, his Mother Goose, said, and what's your name, Little Goose? And I said, well, it's not the Georgie Arthur Trio, Mother, which was the trio that played down in the bar we all went to. Peter fell on the floor, scene went on. To finish the scene, I did the dance that only I could do, if you call it a dance. Meanwhile, Dora's at the back, this was in the museum in those days, and she looked at this, and Jack tried to, and she looked, and then she started, thank God, running down towards the stage. And the curtain came down. As soon as the curtain came down, I flung off stage, threw off the goose's costume, dove under a pile of clothes, and hid. Dora came rushing backstage, stood at the top of the stairs and said, who's in the goose tonight? I cannot thank equity enough. This is, it's fabulous. That's all I can say.